Hey, good morning, everybody. Welcome to church. We're glad that you have joined us this happy Mother's Day to all the moms out there in this room and the ones that are watching online. Thank you, thank you, thank you so much for loving us and taking care of us. I have a story for you this morning. It's a turkey story. So it's turkey season, so I'm going to tell you a turkey story this morning. So I'm going out and I'm going hunting, which I really like to turkey hunt. So I'm going out. Hey, Ginger. You got a haircut. Looks good. Squirrel. So I'm going out turkey hunting, and they're chasing turkeys and just trying to find them and stuff, and I'm having trouble. So I was like, you know what? I'm just going to sit down, and I'm going to read the Lord a psalm. And I never put it, like, in my head, I've never put it that way before. It was always, I'm just going to read. But this time, I was going to read it to Jesus. So when I got distracted a few times, another turkey gobbled, and I ran that way and tried to find it or whatever. But I got back to the place where I was just going to sit down and read the Lord a psalm, which I did. I sat at the base of this tree, and I read a psalm to Jesus. And then all of a sudden, I hear this, these birds walking through the leaves and everything. And if you know anything about turkey hunting, 7 turkeys never come into where you're at. It never happens. So, but 7 turkeys came in to right where I was, and of course I had to pick one out, and thank you, Jesus. Take one of them home to eat. But this isn't really a turkey story. It's more of a God is faithful story. God says that when you seek him with all your heart, you'll find him. And it's true. He wants to give us the desires of our heart. But there's kind of, you're not making a deal with him, but he wants you to seek him first and his kingdom. And then all the other things that he wants you to have, he adds that to you as you go and as you seek him. So he's faithful. So in a morning that was really supposed to be a turkey hunt, I was just reminded of the lesson of what God wants to give us, the good things that he wants us to have in this life, and of course, the amazing things that we can't even conceptualize in the next life. So I hope that encourages you this morning. We're going to have some announcements, and then we'll get started. But happy Mother's Day, and welcome to church. Gobble, gobble. Ladies, if you are already part of the Thursday morning Bible study, then you already know that this coming Thursday is the last Bible study until we reach the summer schedule. If you would like more details on what's coming up this summer and how you're going to meet and get together, you can see Bess Villers or Kay Deffendahl. Thank you.
Grace, it's that time of year again, time to celebrate our 2022 high school graduates. I want to give you some information about what's coming up and ways you can help us celebrate them. Next Sunday, May the 15th, will be Senior Sunday. We will be celebrating our seniors in both services. And out in the foyer, we'll have tables set up where you can go out, see pictures of them throughout their life, leave them a note or a card expressing the congratulations to them in this next step of life. For parents, on the 14th, this coming Saturday, we have our senior dinner. That will begin here at the church at 6:00, a time for us to share stories and just take a few moments to celebrate our graduates together. I want to thank you all for your love and support of our seniors this year. We have a list going through the announcement, has all the names of our seniors. Thank you for your love. Peace out.
Hey,
Hey folks, I have good news and bad news. Bad news is the Old Codgers are no longer meeting at Golden Corral on Wilma Rudolph. But I have great news, they're meeting at a new place, the White House, also known as Casablanca, on the corner of Wilma Rudolph and Trenton Road. Thursdays at noon, come check out the old guys and have a good time. Thanks.
Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for this opportunity that we have to worship you, God. You are good, and you have proven it over and over in our lives, Jesus, and we're asking for the chance this morning to return that back to you in praise. So help us to do that, God. Help our bodies and our voices to go where our hearts have already gone, and that's straight to you. Thank you, Jesus, this morning. Amen.
The author of salvation.
this morning. Let's stand together. Let's praise him.
Stand against the power of our God.
praising this morning. Thank you, Jesus. I said this in first service. Is anybody fighting anything right now? Do you know you're not alone? He's with you, fighting these battles with you. He loves you. He's walking with you. He understands and knows what you're going through and what you need. He does. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. If you're in the middle of it, sing to him this morning. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Good Jesus, we love you this morning.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars.
Down. Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. We could spend our whole lives magnifying and glorifying you with words on how good you are, how great and mighty and powerful, and at the same time, how loving and gracious and understanding of your people, God. We're grateful to you this morning, God. These songs, this music, these hearts, Lord, this morning, they're won over to you. And this rises up from our hearts up to your throne, God. May it be sweet this morning. Thank you, Jesus, for being close to your people, for loving us so much. Thank you, Lord, this morning. I've got a friend closer than a brother. There is no judgment. Oh, how he loves me. I've got a friend, and he is my strength. He is my portion, with me in the valley, with me in the fire, with me in the storm. His mercy is enough. His grace is sufficient. So come if you're needing forgiveness and healing. His mercy is enough. Oh, this is our home. The cross it has spoken. Death is no more. Christ is Lord. Oh, this is our. God really loves us.
this week I had a prayer request come up out of nowhere. Overwhelming, like whack-a-mole. Ever had one of those? Okay, something just pops up. Unexpected, you didn't know it was coming. And it just overwhelming in your life. And I prayed and I brought other people alongside me to pray. And in 70 hours, God answered. You know, praise the Lord for that? That's good. Doesn't it frustrate you when he doesn't work that fast? Okay? Then there are other times we pray, and you pray for weeks, and you pray for months. Sometimes you pray for years. Some people have prayed the same prayers for decades, and then you resent Pastor Rich's very special prayer request that was answered in 70 hours. By the way, I've got some of those that are years long, too. So we just come to God in prayer, and we bring our stuff to the God who already knows, but he told us to come and bring our stuff to him and trust him. And so we've got folks who have come and prayed at the altar. It's not the only place to pray, but it's a pretty cool place to pray. If you'd like to come and kneel at the altar, you're always invited to do that. But let's bow our heads. Let's pray to our good Heavenly Father this morning. God, we thank you that you are awake and you're aware and you're at work in our lives. God, all of the things that we're concerned about, you know us. You know the things that we pray about. God, you know what came up in my life this week. And just in a little bit under 3 days, that prayer was answered. And God, I give you glory for that. And then sometimes we pray, and we bring these needs before you. And it just, from our perspective, it doesn't seem like you're answering. God, help us to trust in you. Help us, Lord, to trust that you are good and close and at work. Help us, Lord, to trust in you. You are the one that can do everything that we can't do. The things we can do, we do, but there's so much that we're out of control with. And God, we pray that you would help us to put our trust in you. Lord, you know our needs this morning. Before we breathe them out, before we pray, you know our needs. And so, God, we can trust you. We pray for Marla Robinson's mother's husband, Jim, as he had his procedure this week and then in recovery. Lord, he's had such difficulty over the last couple of days. Lord, we pray for Jim physically. We pray for Brian Preston. Last Sunday morning, we prayed for Jeannie physically. We prayed for this family, and Jeannie passed away Sunday morning. God, we pray for Brian over these last few days and next few days as the suddenness of family gathering and a celebration of lifetime today on Mother's Day. God, we pray for Brian and his girls and their family. Jesus, we pray for them. We pray for Linda Hall and Dale Vector's daughter, Nikki, for Beth Bird and Shirley Gregory. God, it's good to see faith again this morning. God, we pray for faith physically, emotionally, mentally, relationally. God, we pray your blessing and your closeness with faith. God, be with Virginia, for Dylan and Deanna. God, it's good to see Ginger this morning. God, have your hand on Ginger today and their family. Lord, what hasn't happened in Dylan's life, God, a breakthrough, some good, solid diagnosis, we pray, God, that what hasn't happened yet would happen. Lord, somehow we call out to you and we ask, God, that you would give them a breakthrough. God, be with Jeff Magnuson's mother, Janice. Be with our pastor's wife in Hendersonville. Lord, be with Melanie Harris. God, have your hand on these needs and the many more, these needs represented at the altar this morning. God, today is Mother's Day. It is a day of great joy for many. So some of us in this room had great moms that were wonderful and present and loving. Lord, some of us have great relationships with our kids, and moms and kids are close and near. And so, God, for those situations, we give you great praise. Lord, some today, for our moms, it's a very difficult day. Either relationships with the kids are strained or broken. God, some people here today have lost their mothers recently, or even just it's fresh today because it's Mother's Day. Some moms have lost children. Some ladies would love to be mothers and aren't. Some have lost children before they were even born. God, all of the different aspects of what Mother's Day entails, God, you know every one of us. You know our moms. And I like to remind us all, we either in this room today, we either are great moms, had a great mom, or we know a great mom. So God, help us celebrate today the gift that you've given us, which is family. You chose to tell us who you are in relation to a family. You are a good heavenly Father. You gave marriage to us. You gave mothers and fathers. You put our society together and reflected in a family. So God, we praise you for the gift of moms, and we thank you, Lord, for every woman that is a part of our congregation and is associated with our church family. Lord, help us to give you praise for your good gifts, and we pray that you would bless every lady today. Lord, speak to us today through your word. Speak to us today through your Holy Spirit. Show us Jesus again today, fresh, and we'll give you praise. In your great name we pray. Amen. You can be seated. Glad you're here with us today. And let me remind you of a couple of things. First of all, after church today, we've got a small piece of candy for all you lady types. So if you're a mom, please take some candy. If you're not a mom, but you're a lady type, we'd love for you to have some candy today. I put on the Facebook. That's bad, right? I almost put on Facebook yesterday. In fact, I did put on Facebook for about an hour. Hey, ladies, please come to church tomorrow. We have a small and sweat treat. Proofread, kids. Okay? Sweet treat. So find Ross after church. He has some candy in a basket, and ladies, take one or two of those. We'd love for you to leave with a good memory of today's service. Next Sunday, we're recognizing our, I believe it's nine high school seniors that are, nine, right? Thank you, Micah. Give me the international symbol of that's right. Our nine high school seniors, they're going to have tables out in the foyer. You can see some pictures and memorabilia. They'll have baskets if you'd like to get cards or anything for them. Bless our high school seniors. And then 2 weeks from right now, we've got a men's retreat. We're joining in with our friends at the Hendersonville Church. And if you are a guy and you would like to take part in a men's retreat, see me, see Micah, and we'll give you some more information. It's Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, the 20th, 21st, 22nd. It's $160. We can give you some information about registration, but the deadline is this week. So if you wait too long, it's over. We'll try it again next year. We're going to receive an offering. If we could have some ushers come up and help me with the offering. We have an anniversary offering this morning. Nancy was in first service today, but Delmer and Nancy Burchett have been married 37 years today. There you go. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this act of worship. Bless us, Lord, as we give. Bless those who have much to give. Bless those who have little to give. Bless some who have nothing to give today. God, help us to be givers. Help us to be givers of our finances. Help us to be givers of our influence. Help us to be givers of our time and our witness. Lord, help us to be givers because you are a giver. Help us, Lord, to model our lives after our good Heavenly Father. Lord, we love you and we thank you. In your great name we pray. Amen. So we've been looking at the Sermon on the Mount since the beginning of January. We're in Matthew chapter 6 this morning. If you want to open up your Bibles and turn to Matthew chapter 6, we're going to be looking at this passage. We started looking at chapter 6 last week. Let me tell you a quick story. When I was a kid, late 70s, early 80s, I had a friend named Scott Brenneman. Scott Brenneman was my age. We grew up in a little town in Northwest Ohio called Findlay, and we went to church together. We went to different elementary schools, different middle schools, but Scott was my very best friend. We would sit together and get trouble in church together. We would do children's quizzing. Anybody do children's quizzing? 1, 2, 3, 4, pull out the box and do the thing. We did that. We would eat pizza together. We would watch football together. We would play games, you know, kind of the old after church on Sunday. Families get together. They share a meal together. And the kids all go off and destroy the house. Remember that? Okay. I'd do that with Scott Brenneman. We would go into his room. He had lots of games. He was a Legos guy, and I was not a Legos guy. But that was about the only thing that we didn't do together. We would play Battleship. Remember Battleship? Awesome. Okay. Do you remember the game Mousetrap? And you would spend an hour and a half setting it up and it never ever worked? Okay, we would do that. And then we moved away from Findlay, Ohio in 1983, and I have never spoken to him again. If he is on the Facebook, I have lost him. He was my very best friend. We moved away from Findlay, Ohio. I've not talked to him since. He was my very best friend, 1983. It's almost 40 years ago. I know Scott Brenneman. I also know Dana Cook. And those are night and day how I know those two individuals. See, I knew Scott. Met Scott. I was friends with Scott. We talked a lot. He was my friend. I have been out of contact with him for 39 years. I know Dana. Talked to her this morning. What's up, sugar? Okay, right? So there's a complete difference in how I know Scott, how I know Dana. Jesus is teaching us here in Matthew chapter 6 another principle of knowing our Heavenly Father, following our Heavenly Father, and being a part of the kingdom, being a citizen of the kingdom. He's here in Matthew 5, 6, and 7. He's not just talking about, hey, be good so someday you can die and go to heaven. He's telling us again, the kingdom is here. The kingdom is at hand, and you can live lives right now in the kingdom. Start now. Be citizens of the kingdom. We live in kingdoms of this world. We live in kingdoms of America. We lived in kingdoms of haves and have-nots, people who are healthy, people who aren't healthy, people who are this color, people who are this color, people of this nationality, people of this nationality. We have lots of different fighting kingdoms, and Jesus says, I want you to put my kingdom first and pray for my kingdom to come. And here in chapter 6, he gives us a couple of instructions on how we can operate between us and him. So we're going to read in chapter 6. If you would like to this morning, you can stand up in honor of God's word. There are three sections that start out chapter 6. And this is the foundation for all of them. Chapter 6, verse 1 starts out like this. Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. In other words, this is how not to be religious. Don't just be religious. Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you'll have no reward from your Father in heaven. Now, then in verse 5, he teaches us how to pray. When you pray, the assumption is that we pray. If we know him, if we're following him, we pray. We talk to God. When you pray, don't be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they've received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they'll be heard because of their many words. Don't be like them, for your Father knows what you need even before you ask. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You can be seated. So Jesus starts out chapter 6 by saying, be careful not to do your acts of righteousness in front of other people for show. Don't do these things just to be seen. And the first thing he said, and we looked at last week, was when you give, don't be a show off about your money. Hey, Drake, look at my $100 bill. I'm waving it big. You see how good I am? I got lots of cash. I'm putting it in the offering. Don't you think I'm special? Don't do that. Give humbly. Give quietly. Give to God, not so somebody sees you. And then he changes gears. So he says, the assumption is you will give. We give because God is a giver. When you pray, he says. So he starts off with a few don'ts. And we're going to come back next week and look at this passage again. Next week is going to be more about the Lord's Prayer. If you want to, I'll give you a little bit of homework. Go back in the YouTube. See what I did there? Go back in YouTube. In January and February of 2018, I preached on the Lord's Prayer. I preached for weeks on the Lord's Prayer, looking at every phrase from the Lord's Prayer and how we can communicate with God, how He teaches us. He gave us the Lord's Prayer not just so we would memorize the Lord's Prayer, then to spit it back out. He gave us the Lord's Prayer as a model. You can pray this, then this, then this, then this. And we'll look at that next week. Today we're going to look at the part before what Jesus teaches. When you pray, don't pray like this. And he gives some instruction. Anybody know what the Babylon Bee is? The Babylon Bee is a satire website for Christians. And so he gives us the Babylon Bee. These are techniques to ensure that God will hear your prayers. Ready? These are tips. Say Father God at least 72 times during your prayer. So you re-engage his memory. Father God this, Father God that, Father God this, Father God that. Set the mood by hiring some Gregorian monks to chant in the background. Sprinkle in some hot gossip. That'll make your prayer more interesting to God. Make sure you're wearing a Christian t-shirt or a cross necklace. That way your prayers will really get supersized. Always pray inside of a Hobby Lobby or a Chick-fil-A. Boom. You pray inside Chick-fil-A and that just rings a bell in heaven and the Lord's paying attention then. And then always make sure you close your prayers like this. But your will be done or whatever. Okay? You've always got to close with a your will be done, even if it's, you know, you're strong arming and it's like he's squeezing it out of you. Jesus gives us some direction here on how we should pray, and he starts in verse 5. When you pray, don't be like the hypocrites. Hypocrites, that word there is actor. And in Jesus' day, and really in our day today, some can pray for show. When you pray, don't be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by other people. Have you ever been listening to somebody pray and you just get this weird feeling inside that this is a show? They're not really talking to God. They're talking for you to hear them. I don't hear that a lot, but every now and then I'm hearing somebody and I'm thinking, these aren't the words that you use when you talk to me. Lots of these and thous and saith and doeth and all those kinds of King Jamesy language, okay? Sometimes we're, don't do this, performing. In Jesus' day, the religious men, sorry ladies, there weren't really any religious ladies leading in Jesus' day. They weren't allowed. In Jesus' day, the religious men would stand up and be singled out. They would stand up in the temple or in the synagogue. They would stand up in the street corners. They would raise their voices, "Our Heavenly Father." You know, they would really start to lay it on. And they would pray for attention. Jesus comes along and says, "Buddy, if you get attention because you're praying, that's your reward." And it ends there. And Jesus starts this, how not to be religious, by saying, don't do that. "Truly I tell you, they've received their reward." Verse 6, "But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father." This is actually a pretty good practice. You've heard of people using the term prayer closet? Okay? Go in, get quiet, get alone, talk to your Heavenly Father. There's nobody in there to impress. It's you and the Lord. Go in, get quiet, and pray. Your Heavenly Father sees what is done in secret, and He will hear you. Then in verse 7, "And when you pray, don't keep on babbling like pagans. They think they'll be heard because of their many words." You don't have to be repetitive. You don't have to say the same thing. You don't have to use super words, okay? Some people think that the Lord's not going to pay attention to your prayer until you say the magic words, "In Jesus' name." If you forget to throw an "in Jesus' name" at the end of your prayers, all the previous words don't count. That's not true. Do we pray in Jesus' name? I don't know any other way to pray. Do you start your prayer by "Our Heavenly Father," or "Father," or "God," or "Jesus," or "Holy Spirit"? How do you start your prayers? I'm kind of a, this is my personal habit. I'm kind of a Jesus guy. I say, "Oh, Jesus," okay? That's how I start my prayers. You listen to Charlotte pray, and I never noticed this until Joe brought it up one time. Charlotte starts every prayer with one word. Do you know what the word is? "And." She starts every prayer with "and." "And Lord," "and Jesus." You know, I have a theory. She's already been praying. This is just a continuation. Okay? Don't think that you've got to pray according to some certain super words, super religious words. He wants us to talk to Him. Watch how a kid talks to a good parent. I believe that's how God wants us to talk to Him. God wants intimacy in our prayer life. God wants closeness in our prayer life. Don't just keep babbling like the pagans do. Jesus says, "Your Heavenly Father knows what you need before you ask Him." So why ask Him? That's a pretty good question. If He knows what you need before you ask Him, why ask Him? Well, because He wants you to talk to Him. He wants you to bring your needs to Him. He's not, you know, faith praying to the Lord, "God, you know what my lungs are like. You know what my physical needs are." And I don't believe God up in heaven is, "Oh my gosh, I completely forgot, Faith. I'm glad you reminded me." Right? God knows. So why does He want us to pray? Because He wants relationship with us. He wants dependence from us. He wants intimacy from us. Several things you don't have to do. You don't have to pray eloquently. You don't have to have fancy schmancy Shakespeare words. You don't have to have super duper churchy words. You know, sometimes we think that we've got to pray in a way that we would never talk to our families like this. Think, after a meal, you're sitting down, you've had a meal, and your kid asks you for dessert. "Dearest Father, we first would like to thank you for your kind provision in our former days. Furthermore, we know that you have the ability to grant requests. Furthermore, in addition, we ask, we humbly beseech thee that undeserving as we are in your great mercy that we could have ice cream, if that be'est your will. Kids look at you and they raise their eyebrows and they go, ice cream? Right? Which way do you think God wants us to come to him? Now, we'll look again. Next week, we're going to look at the Lord's Prayer, specifically the steps in the Lord's Prayer. If you are a memorizer and if you have memorized the Lord's Prayer, awesome. It's a great model, but that's what it is. It's a model, and we can model our prayers after that. Jesus knows your request. You don't have to have super selective words to say. Your prayers don't have to be long. Some folks pray long prayers. You all have that one uncle in your family. And if it's Thanksgiving and they're asked to pray, you know all the food's cold by the time anybody gets to take a bite. And God forbid if that long-winded uncle is also a crier. Because if they're a crier, you just might as well get comfortable because it's going to be halftime of the second game before anybody eats any turkey. Your prayers don't have to be long. If you pray long, good. If you pray short little prayers, wonderful. Pray them throughout the day. Think about your closest human relationship. Dane and I talk in the morning. We talk throughout the day. I text her. She texts me. We talk after school, we talk over dinner, we talk before bed at night. It's a continual conversation. Some of those bits of conversation are 15 seconds. One of the greatest prayers in the world, God, help! He knows all that stuff. You can talk for an extra 15 minutes, but he knows what God help means. If your kids came running to you and they said, Dad, help, would you spring into action? Would you do something? How much more so your Heavenly Father? Your prayers don't have to be long. If you have long bits of time to give prayer, or if you just pray in chunks throughout the day, wonderful. Let me just tell you something. God's not going anywhere. You don't just have a tiny little bit of time to cram everything in. Pray. Then, through the power of the Holy Spirit, come back later, pray some more. As you remember something, pray some more. As God brings something into your life, pray some more. Something hit me this week. On Tuesday, something hit me this week, and I immediately thought, God, help! And I prayed, and I enlisted other people to pray with me, took it to Dana, shared it with her, and we prayed. And I'm telling you, 70 hours later, we had an answer to prayer. I love that. God doesn't always go that fast, and that drives me nuts. We think sometimes that prayer should be like you put a quarter in the machine, you turn the thing, and all the Jolly Ranchers come out, right? Not Jolly Ranchers. No, what do you like so much? Hot tamales, that's Dana's jam, okay? The hot tamales at Hoppery Mills. You put the quarters in, you thing the thing, and you get your treat. Prayer isn't like that. Sometimes we pray for days, weeks, months. Sometimes but you don't have to cram it all into one setting. Your prayers don't have to be repetitive. Go back to the dessert thing. Chocolate ice cream. We love chocolate ice cream. We'd like some chocolate ice cream. A big bowl of chocolate ice cream. My brother likes chocolate ice cream. My sister loves chocolate ice cream. And then you got to get your prayer voice. My sister loves chocolate. We like sprinkles on our ice cream. Don't. You don't have to be repetitive. Oh, what God wants from us is intimacy. At the end of the day, he knows. He knows. But there's got to be a reason why he wants us to keep coming back to him. Find your own time. If you're an early morning prayer, God bless your little baby heart. My dad was an early morning prayer. When I was a kid, bedroom was back here, long hallway, bathroom, kitchen. And in the living room, my dad, a lot of times if I would wake up early, I'd see my dad in the living room, he would be kneeling at the couch and he would be praying. That's kind of a cool heritage. That's a great memory for me. My dad would be there praying before the sun would come up. He'd pray for our family, pray for my mom and my brother and me, and he'd pray for the church and he'd pray for needs. And so then when I got all growed up, I thought that's how Christian men did it, right? So I woke up real early one morning and I went and I knelt at the couch before the sun came up and fell asleep. Must not have a tenth of the spirituality that my dad had. And I decided to do better the next day, and I got up, and everything that I said to the Lord was, this is not working out. I've got to find a different habit. I'm not an early morning prayer. I pray in the morning, but it's usually after coffee, and I think the Lord understands that. And we talk throughout the day. Sometimes we do little fast, jiffy prayers, sometimes longer prayers. When this building was built, the pastor's office, right over here, the pastor's office has a little extra office. And a lot of people don't even know about that little room, the bookshelves, and it's a little quiet space. I can go in there and hide. Sometimes people walking up and down the hallway, there's a window in the door, they see me, they just pop in. And sometimes so many people pop in, I'm not getting anything done. So I hide. I'm sorry. But I'll go into that little room and I'll hide. And sometimes I go in there and I just am quiet. And I listen to the Lord. That doesn't have to be at 4:30 in the morning. Some of you want to, you know, pray at night, but then you fall asleep again. So it's kind of a tricky wicket there. You find a place, find a time that fits who you are. Talk to him. Make a list. Somebody comes up and Jeff says, Rich, I really need you to pray with me about this. Write it down. Put it in your phone. Make a reminder. I've got a list. That's why I write things out on Sunday mornings, because I'm not a good rememberer. We wanted to pray for Marla's mom's husband, and we forgot in first service because I didn't write it down. And then we remembered. Pray. What God wants from you isn't long prayers, it's not fancy prayers, it's not babbling prayers, and it's certainly not public prayers. What God wants is your heart. And like a good child loves a good parent, he wants relationship and intimacy. And he gives us a prayer to pray. Not just so we'll memorize the Lord's Prayer, but so we'll have a model to follow. We're going to look at that next week. Here's just what I think. In this room, we've got Christians. We've got believers. We've got people who follow Jesus that struggle with prayer. You know how I know this? Because I'm 51 years old, I've known and loved Jesus most of my life, and I still, some days, struggle in prayer. I talked to a senior citizen after first service, and she said, I struggle with prayer. He gives us a model. What he wants isn't just fancy words. It's not just long, lengthy prayers. What he wants from us is our hearts and our attention and our affection and our worship. And so he gives it to us pretty plainly. In Luke, in the gospel according to Luke, Luke shares this same story. But it's premised not in the Sermon on the Mount. It's his disciples, those who follow Jesus. They come to him. They've seen Jesus' prayer. They've seen Jesus' prayer life, and the disciples come and say, Jesus, would you teach us how to pray like that? And he gives them this prayer. We're going to look at that next week. If you struggle with prayer, would you do this week? Go someplace, get quiet, get alone, eliminate, you know, turn your phone off, because as soon as your phone goes, you're off again. Get alone, get quiet, and just say, hey, God, comma, and then just, yeah, I know, comma. Hey, God, and then just start to talk to him. He knows. He wants to have a conversation with you. God speaks to us through his word. God speaks to us through the family, through brothers and sisters in Christ. God speaks to us through the Holy Spirit. Sometimes God speaks to us into our hearts, into our spirits, when we're quiet long enough to listen to Him. We speak to God in prayer. Let's build that relationship. Would you stand up with me? Let's pray together. Oh God, somebody here this morning is struggling. Somebody here today feels inadequate when it comes to prayer. Feels like it's not personal, it's not consistent. It just seems like an empty, hollow religious chore. Would you help us? Help us to develop this spiritual act of worship, this spiritual act of prayer, communing with you, building our relationship day after day, moment after moment, a lifetime of building intimacy with our good, loving Heavenly Father. Our times of prayer should be personal and rich and sweet. God, we're not there yet. Would you help us? Do something in us this week that brings us closer to you in these next 7 days. Then, Lord, bring us back together next Sunday as we look at this passage again and see your model, this framework on how we can come to you and how we can communicate with you. Lord, teach us to pray. In your great name we pray. Amen.
I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see your promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life. All throughout my history, your faithfulness has walked beside me. The winter storms make way for spring. In every season, from where I'm standing, I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see your promises and fulfillment all over my life, all over my life.
Help me remember when I'm weak. Fear may come, but fear will leave. You lead my heart to victory. You are my strength, and you are. And fulfillment all over my life, all over my life. See the cross, the empty grave, the evidence is endless. All my sin rolled away because of you, oh Jesus. See the cross, the empty grave, the evidence is endless. Sin rolled away because of you, oh Jesus. Oh, I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, see your promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life. And why should I fear? Oh, the evidence is here. And why should
Jesus, so help your people today, God, to communicate with you, Lord, to take this week and set it apart and spend time with you, even spend time with you being quiet and listening to what you might have to say to us this week. God, give us strength. God, help us this week as we get ready to get out of here, Jesus. We're going to meet tons of people that need to be prayed for. So God, give us the strength to do that. Open up our minds and our hearts, God, so that we can see clearly into the world that you've called us into to witness to. So help us, Jesus. We thank you, Lord. Amen. Let's sing the doxology this morning together.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
So ladies, grab some candy on the way out. I believe Ross is going to be out there, and he's got the candy. He's the candy man. Everything left over goes to me and Joe. Spend time this week.
You don't want any candy.
Working on that prayer. Just stop long enough and be quiet before God and talk to Him like you'd talk to a good earthly father, good earthly mother, a friend who's there with you, present, close, and who loves you. Let me bless you as you go today. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you put your trust in Him so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. God bless you. Have a great afternoon. Happy Mother's Day. You're dismissed.